think I always knew that I wanted to do something that was music related. And in the beginning, it all stemmed from a fascination with synthesizers, and therefore I became a keyboard player. And as a development of that, I became a programmer of electronic instruments. And so through the late 80s and early 90s, I was working in the record business, making records in that role, which led to working more in music production as opposed to just, you know, the session musician thing. And then I kind of fell into the world of music for media, as you call it, rather by accident, because there was an Australian director who was making a strange modernized version of Romeo and Juliet, who became attached to some of the records that I was working on, particularly the ones I was working on with Nellie Hooper at the time, and came and tracked us down and said he wanted us to work on this movie he was making, which involved both producing and arranging a bunch of songs for it, but also doing the score.
And this was the DiCaprio Romeo and Juliet.
This is the DiCaprio Romeo and Juliet. So I was immediately intrigued by the idea. I had no idea what I was getting into. I don't think any of the team that Baz approached really did, but it sounded like a great adventure, and that's exactly what it turned into. We jumped from never having done a score at all to suddenly scoring a relatively major Fox movie. And I think there was some nervousness at the studio because, you know, the studios love a track record and we didn't have one. So it was really due to the fact that Baz doubled down and really believed in us that enabled us to survive the initial stages. And then, you know, the work was going well, and so slowly they left us to it.
Well, this film, Coda, is extraordinary, and it's got 3 Oscar nominations. It's won 2 BAFTAs. It had the top honor at SAG. It had the top prize at PGA. There's a reason why people love it, and I want to get into that. But first of all, I want to jump back to a film you worked on a few years ago, because I'm a stickler for Justin Hurwitz and particularly for Damien Chazelle, and I love how they both sort of ascended into film together. And I'm interested in your role on La La Land and what that experience was like working on a film like that.
Here's to the ones who dream, foolish as they may seem. Here's to the hearts that ache. Here's to the mess we make.
Well, first of all, it was a real pleasure working with Damien. He was for a director so young, he's one of the most clear-sighted and imaginative and authoritative directors that I've ever worked with. So he makes things easy because although he's very, very demanding and exacting, he's also very clear about what he wants. And he has this long relationship with Justin, which goes way back to when they were roommates at Harvard. And you know, generally speaking, they're pretty self-sufficient in the work that they do. But with a project like La La Land, which had all of this performative ingredients, all of these performative ingredients to it, it was something that neither of them had tackled before. And I think they acknowledged that they needed some help. So I was really there just to guide the process and try to help them not make any mistakes, and also try to mediate between the studio and them in cases where the studio maybe had ideas about what the project needed to be that didn't quite gel with what Damien was making.
Yeah, and like what you were talking about.
In the end, we all got onto the same page and it was fine. But in the early days, you know, you're starting up, you know, you're going to spend a lot of money on a musical, and you want to make sure that you're you know, doing something which also makes commercial sense.
Yeah, it's a fascinating project just because of the different kinds of music that's involved in it. Obviously, there's the original score aspect, there's the songs, there's the music being played in the jazz clubs that's sort of diegetic, and then there's the music that's being played by John Legend and his band in the movie. So it had to have been interesting going through those different arenas of music within one film.
Absolutely, it was. I mean, that's a skill set that I picked up again, pretty early because of Baz Luhrmann's influence, because he's the master of that kind of eclecticism. And so that didn't scare me about La La Land, but for sure, yes, it needed careful management.
Guys, this is not the Pledge of Allegiance. It's a love song, a love song. Try to imagine what it's like to sacrifice everything for another human, okay?
So again?
Can we talk a little bit about the director of Coda, Sean?
Yeah.
Can you talk about when you first met her and what her initial pitch to you was for this movie? And how you sort of reacted
pitch,
to it?
Her pitch was very simple. I was introduced to her by Patrick, one of the producers of the film, who'd taken the project with him when he left Lionsgate. He obviously was a producer on La La Land as well, so that was the connection there. And Sean and I went out for a cocktail in New York. I was on my way back to London from Los Angeles, and we just sat down, and she didn't pitch it to me. I knew the script. She just told me what she was trying to do, which is the most authentic possible representation of the music that she wanted to use and the culture that she wanted to delineate in the story. And I was just so immediately impressed with her commitment to that authenticity that I knew it was a film that I wanted to work on.
How did you particularly connect to the music aspect of the story? Because it obviously plays a central role in the main character and the main narrative. So how did you personally, as a composer and a musician, connect to the themes of the film?
I mean, the music of Coda is really born out of the story because there's a school choir element to it. And that's where we started with what we knew we were going to shoot. And then tracking the development of Ruby as a singer through the film by creating these choir arrangements that were increasingly sophisticated and increasingly gave her a chance to show what she could do, and then building out her solo performances of songs like Both Sides Now.
I took one look at you, and it was plain to see you were my destiny.
With my arms open wide, I threw away my pride.
So that was the starting point, and then we just tried, as we turned to the score, to make sure that the score felt like it was born out of the same kind of real grounding that the diegetic music was, so that it all felt of a piece, with the additional complication that so many of the dialogue scenes are conducted in what we thought was going to be silence, but actually isn't silence at all, because you hear a lot of interesting physical detail if you stick a microphone close to people who are communicating with sign language. And we soon became aware of how powerful that could be in scenes that played dry, which is why there is basically no score in the first half of the film. And then the score grows out of Ruby's increasing confidence as a musician and becomes more fully fledged by the end.
Right, and the final sequence of the film is, I mean, it's hard to leave the theater sort of not having any tear. I mean, just the way that the music is written, and it's just beautiful. Can you talk a little bit about how the process began? Because I'm sure that you had to do certain arrangements before they shot the film, because they had to shoot with those elements. Can you talk about which of those elements you had to prepare before the movie started production?
We knew we wanted to record as much of the music and as many of the vocals live as possible. Again, you know, speaking to Sean's quest for authenticity. So we knew we would need to cast people who are, you know, both capable enough to be able to sing it and also not too capable, so that it didn't feel like a school choir. So occasionally the music needed to sound not very good. But everything that had to be shot had to be prepared and rehearsed, and the arrangements had to be written. So we had six or seven choir arrangements to do, and then the duet to do with Ferdia and Amelia, and then Amelia's big performance of Both Sides Now. We treated it as if we were going to go in with pre-records, so we made everyone, you know, record their parts. But then when we got onto set, we sort of abandoned the pre-records and just let everyone sing. And there's very little vocal performance in Coda which isn't recorded live on set.
Now, are all
which
of
is
the
a testament to my partner Nick's work, because who was the music producer on the film, because I was unable to be on set on this occasion, and so he did a great job in terms of working with the sound department and making sure everything was recorded as well as possible.
The main actress is a really brilliant actress in this movie, and like her character arc is sort of matched by her vocal arc. She continues to grow throughout the film, and by the time you get to that final sequence with the audition at Berkeley, it's just a really fantastic arc. So can you talk a little bit about her role in the film and how you worked with her in any way to sort of build up that that arc over the film?
We knew that we wanted to, or we knew that we had to track that sort of in progression through the story of the film, but it was kind of very easy to do that because Amelia, like Ruby, her character, started off as she has a naturally beautiful voice, but she hadn't done a lot of singing, certainly not in public. She called herself a shower singer. So, you know, as we needed in the story to track Ruby's development from a non-singer to an expert singer, it was exactly the same with Amelia in her preparation process.
Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
And we just took notes of the experiences that she was having as she was learning to sing, and the frustrations and the sense of breakthrough when something worked, and kind of, she was able to grab all that and use that as an anchor for her performances in the film.
When it comes to director-composer relationships, what was particular about this project and about Sean's vision for the film? And who was the person other than Sean that you were working with closest during the creation of the score and of the music?
Well, my Nikolai Baxter, who was, as I said, the music producer, he and I worked very closely throughout the whole thing. One of the reasons I wanted to go into this one as a full partnership like that was I knew that I had some fairly significant scheduling issues. And so I needed someone I could trust to kind of, to get it done. And Nick was the perfect, I've been working with him for years and he's fantastic, but he was the perfect accomplice for that. So he was the one I worked with most closely. And whenever we were working on the film, whilst the other person wasn't, we kept in very close touch to make sure that we both understood where it was going. But then beyond that, I mean, the music process was very intimate. Giraud, the editor, was someone we spoke to a lot, and he was very very responsive and collaborative. But really, it was just to do with the relationship between Nick and myself and Sean, and, you know, getting increasingly acquainted with what she wanted, challenging her where that felt right, because, you know, it's her own admission that she's not particularly she wouldn't call herself a musical expert, which is ironic because she ended up co-writing the song that got shortlisted for the Academy. So, but that happened much later. Sean was really really clear about how she wanted everything to feel authentic and as unmanipulative as possible, which meant she drove both of us towards a kind of simplicity in our approach that perhaps neither of us had been that used to up until this point. She certainly, you know, we all began to realize that she was right, that the music needed, the score needed a lot of silence in it. But sometimes just in terms of paring the music down so that it was as elegantly simple as possible, that's very much to her credit that we ended up in this place.
Had to have been really interesting because you were obviously involved really early on in the process before anything was shot. And then of course you go in for a second round once the film is shot and you're the composer of the film and you've got the original score to write. What was it like when you first sat down and you're watching the assembly? Because I'm sure they first sent you a really rough assembly of the film as footage was coming in. What was it like seeing what you've been told about come alive on the screen, and what were those initial ideas that hit you for the score?
The initial ideas were really born out of the language of the songs, to try and make a score that fitted in seamlessly with the main musical story of the film, which is the sequence of songs. But interestingly, you're right, normally you get sat down in front of an assembly, which is radically different to how the film eventually ends up. But I will say in this case, the first cut that they showed me, we made a lot of changes to in the subsequent weeks, which then reverted. And honestly, they got it pretty much right first time. It's not often I've seen that, where a first cut is so very close to how the final cut was. I mean, yeah, there was lots of nips and tucks, but essentially Giraud and Sean locked themselves away for 10 weeks and came out with the movie, and it was pretty much right to begin with. And then, of course, we all started second guessing it and changing it unnecessarily.
Yeah, which is always part of it. You're always going back and thinking you could do something differently and that kind of thing. Can you talk a little bit about the instrumentation for the score? Because it is an intimate score. It's a heavily acoustic score. You're not going to find a ton of synths. It's very organic, I would say. Can you talk about how you put together the palette for the score and what your approach was in regards to that simplicity and that organic quality?
Again, it's the same thing. It needed to feel like it was of a piece with the language of the songs, and the language of the songs, at least to begin with, are just piano and voice in the school rehearsal room. And then, you know, when we get to both sides now, we gave ourselves permission to introduce a little bit of orchestration and a little bit of supportive texture, but it was clear that the score had to be grounded in the same kind of simple organic approach. And so, and it being, as I said earlier, you know, having started off as a synthesist, I'm the first person to start getting out the clever sound design and the hardware synths. But on this occasion, it just felt like it needed to be told as simply as possible with real instruments. And that was it. It's no more complicated than that.
Right. What were the elements on the film that were actually recorded on set live? I'm curious whether some of the scenes in the classroom amongst the kids, like whether those things were recorded live or whether those
all of it.
Wow.
I mean, maybe a couple of little patches afterwards in ADR, but there isn't a performed scene in the film that wasn't captured live.
And what was the process of spotting the film like? Because as you said, and it's apparent when you watch the film, there's less score in the beginning, and then as the character of Ruby, you know, continues her arc throughout the film, the music definitely grows and its prominence throughout the film. So why did you make that decision to have the music build like that? And what do you think that contributes to the experience?
It's what I was speaking about earlier with the richness of the dialogue scenes, particularly the family interaction scenes. When you watch it down, and the on-set sound mixer did a fantastic job capturing all of that detail. So I initially scored throughout the whole film because I really didn't want to appear lazy, but I kind of knew that there was going to be an important conversation between music and silence. And then, we listened through and it was just a question of pruning and removal. We just took the music out here, took the music out here. Yes, that works better. There's a little bit here. You know, we're at the beginning of Act Two. It feels like we could do with some support. So the first two or three score cues are almost inaudible. You know, they're just a tiny little bleed of sound to get your ears used to what's going on. And then it became obvious to us fairly early on that this was the right thing to do, to let the underscore grow as the main character's musical sensibility started to blossom.
I took one look at you, and it was plain to see you were my destiny.
Ruby!
With my arms open wide, I threw away my pride. I'll sacrifice for you, dedicate my life to you.
I think one of the most brilliant things about this movie, first of all, the essence of how Sean is so dedicated to being authentic, and the way that sound contributes to that throughout the film. There's multiple moments where the sound will be pulled out so that the audience can have a better understanding. It's a really interesting technique. Can you talk a little bit about, I know there's a sequence at the end of the film during the talent show where the sound comes out for a really good amount of time.
I will go where you lead.
Sean always had in mind that we would do that in that scene. And there's actually a couple of other moments in the film where we do that to a lesser extent, like the moment on the boat where they're being arrested by the Coast Guard. The dialogue disappears and you're left with just the sound effects, but they're still talking. So we started to flirt with that idea earlier in the film, but we knew that this performance of the duet was where we really wanted to go for it. And it was just long, long discussions about how slowly we should fade into silence, how we should come back into production sound at the end of it when the audience are applauding, whether that should be really clever and sound designy or just a simple fade. What would happen when we got to silence? Did we really want silence? Which is, in a cinema, extremely confronting, because all of a sudden the sounds in the theater become really loud. You know, you hear the projection and you hear the rustling of sweet wrappers, and actually no one's unwrapping sweets at that point. But you know what I mean? You're suddenly sort of put into this weird space where you're halfway between what you're watching as a performance and the world that you're in. So we experimented with various types of room tone, and you know, but in the end it was, and probably knowing Sean, it was inevitable that it would be just the simple solution. We faded the sound out and then we faded it back in. End of story.
And there's often that little bit of bass, though, also, because, you know, Troy's character, like, they show that in the film, that when he's listening to music in the car, he has rap music on, because that's the music that he can actually hear. He can hear the vibrations of that music. So that's also clear in the sound as well.
We had fun doing that, because it was the rattling of the car, and we took the, in the mix, we took the almost finished mix, fed it back into speakers very loudly in the control room, and just had all of this industrial metal and trays full of cutlery, and just recorded the rattling of all of this metal in response to the bass tones. And that was a fun day.
I remember talking to John Lunn about his experience working on Downton, and he talked about how whenever there's diegetic music for those particular episodes, he's always on set and he wants to make sure that everything... Were you on set at all? And if so, what was that experience like?
I wasn't on set with Coda because of a scheduling conflict. So Nick handled that part of the process. But generally, yes, I do go on set for all of the diegetic stuff, and I make sure that it's going to work within the overall musical context of the film, and also technically. On this occasion, I was fortunate to have Nick as a partner in crime, so he was able to handle all that.
The ending song is extraordinary, and you know, she performed it at the BAFTAs, which I thought was great.
Yeah.
What was the process like, and how did that particular piece of music, Both Sides Now, which is Joni Mitchell's song, how did that evolve, and how was that particular song chosen? Was that in the original script by Sean?
No, it was not in the original script. But as we were populating the film with song titles, it was a constant dance between what we could obtain the rights to, what we could afford, because this was a tiny movie in terms of its budget, and so we didn't have anything like unlimited resources to license music. Great job by Alexandra, our music supervisor, in getting to where we got to. But we on one of the long phone calls, the idea of Both Sides Now came up, and I think we all immediately responded to it and thought, well, wouldn't that be perfect, but we'll never be able to get it. And it just so happened, Both Sides Now happened to be owned, the rights happened to be owned by the same people as we were doing our package deal with for many of the other songs. And so we were able to get it at an affordable price. Once we started playing with it and putting it into Amelia's voice, it was obvious that it was the right song. And we were just lucky, first of all, that we were able to get the permission to use it, and doubly lucky that when the film eventually came out, Joni Mitchell responded so warmly to it and said how thrilled she was with the version. So with all of the success and recognition that Coda has achieved, for us as a music department, that was almost the most important thing.
It's cloud illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all.
And what was your process like for the actual arrangement? Because I just love how the song builds and the strings come in, and then by the time you get to the end, it just has such an amazing crescendo. What was your approach to giving it sort of a, because I know it goes one full verse, one full chorus, I mean, with just the piano, what just the vocals. So how did you decide how to build that particular piece?
It's actually two verses and two choruses before anything happens. Clearly, we wanted it to start in the space, and we wanted it just to be piano and voice. So that was simply a question of finding a musical arrangement that was just piano and voice, that was both sufficiently interesting and to do justice to the song, but also sufficiently plain to feel as if it could work as a diegetic scene. And that was that was just an evening that I spent working out, you know, what this song might sound like on as piano and voice rather than guitar and voice, which is how I'm normally used to hearing it, or orchestra and voice if you hear the 2000 version. And for the longest time, it was just a piano and voice arrangement. And then when we eventually saw the cut, and we saw that we went into a sort of out of the real space into a montage sequence for the third verse, then Nick and I felt very strongly that we wanted to just give it a little bit more weight and detail and orchestration there. And Sian wasn't sure about that at all for the longest time. She was like, well, yeah, but where are these violins coming from? And eventually her husband very kindly intervened and said, no, this is a film, you're allowed to do that.
Still somehow.
For your process on this film, because the score is so organic and you can just feel how every single instrument is real in this score when you listen to it, were you recording stuff throughout the process, or was it something where you were using samples and then at the end you brought in musicians to put it together?
Did it all with samples, then just got a great small group of musicians in right at the end to play it.
Gotcha.
And what were the string section? I was a quartet, just a string quartet. My good friend Joel on guitars, and a little bit of French horn and a little bit of trumpet from Stuart Cole. Victoria Theodore played all of the piano parts amazingly. So I'm probably forgetting some. Oh, Joey Warrenka played drums. So, you know, that's maybe eight or nine people, many of my favorite musicians. It was a fun session. And we got a whole score recorded in 2 days.
Do you have something to say?
You will be required to have a hearing individual on board at all times.
I can't stay with you for the rest of my life. Before.
At the beginning of this project, did you have any sort of inkling of an idea how big of an impact this film would have, and how much it would connect? What's it been like for you to see how much it's connected with people?
I mean, I never like to invest in results. So, you know, my criterion for the success or failure of a film is whether I feel that we've all done justice to what the film's capabilities were, rather than how it performs in the marketplace. But it got to Sundance, won the prizes there, and that's when I realized that it's, you know, not only were we going to be proud of it, but it was actually going to connect successfully with audiences. But I didn't know whether that was just going to be a really, you know, great run on the festival circuit. Best Picture nomination, I don't think anyone saw that coming, but not that I don't think it's deserved, and I think, you know,
yeah,
Patrick and the other producers deserve to win that award.
I think everyone has their fingers crossed for you, and I think that
we'll see. You know, it's a big and strong category. So,
yeah,
we'll be celebrating whatever happens on Sunday.
You have a lot of great people that you're standing next to. Steven Spielberg is one of them, and Del Toro, and Kenneth Branagh. So it's a great group of films this year, particularly.
Oscar goes to...
Okay, Coda.
Now, since you're speaking to an audience of mostly composers, we're obviously in a really interesting age because streaming has become, I mean, this is an Apple TV film that we're talking about, but there's original films being made for basically every single streaming distributor out there. And of course, you have theatrical films, you have network television, so there's an infinite amount of media being created now that needs an original score. So how do you think the industry has changed and What do you think about these new opportunities that have come about for composers out there?
Well, it's good that we have a universe in which more composers are getting paid. That's definitely something to be celebrated. On the other hand, the proliferation of material comes with its own problems in terms of navigating your way through it as a consumer and an appreciator, and also just the simple laws of quality control when there's so much volume. I think in terms of my experience working with an increasing amount of streaming projects, the thing which is the most challenging is how to mix it at the end, you know? I mean, I love hearing music that I've been involved in on a big dubbing stage played really loud as if in a theater. And it makes you approach your music mixes very differently than if you're making a record that's going to be listened to in a stereo system. But with anything that's going to be a pure streaming project, it's sometimes going to be heard on a domestic 5.1 system, but it's never really going to be heard in a theater. And it's...
Yeah, so it was probably mixed for Atmos. I mean, basically every single screening situation, people who are watching at their living room on 5.1 systems, all those different avenues, I'm sure.
But also people watch movies on their telephones.
And on their laptops.
It all has to work, and on their laptops and on their tablets. So,
yeah. So do you take the approach in that kind of a situation, like let's mix this the best possible screening scenario, so like for the theatrical experience?
It just means you focus on different things. Like you spend a lot of time when you're mixing in the theater thinking about what's going into the subspeakers. And when you know that 90% of the people are going to watch the thing are going to be watching it without any kind of sub-channel at all, it's not that you ignore that, it's just that you start to focus more on, well, the clarity of the mix as if it was a stereo mix. Whilst also trying to make sure it's going to play okay on all of the different potential formats.
What's the biggest thing that you took away from the experience of working on Coda that you'll sort of remember as you continue?
Just a great team of people and a great sense of family and a great sense of experiencing the whole journey from, you know, the tiny little inception ideas we had for it through the making of it, through the scoring of it, and then you know, through the next year, the increasingly favorable and warm reception that it's received in the world. It's been a great journey.
Right. And just a little bit about your next projects that I'd love for you to have the opportunity to talk about. I know that you're working with one of my favorite filmmakers, Joshua Oppenheimer, on a project.
Well, that's not too much here, but that one is going to be an absolute doozy. Yeah,
because you're...
Joshua's amazing, but as you know, he hasn't worked fast. You know, he's done two movies, both harrowing documentaries.
And very harrowing.
We're going to make a harrowing musical to go along with those.
What an interesting choice for him. I always thought about it because his documentaries are so visceral and interestingly dark, and then he's going into this golden age musical. It's an interesting...
It will still be viscerally dark, I can promise you that.
That's very good. Well, it looks like a great cast, and so you'll be starting on that next year.
We've started preparation on it, but we shoot it, fingers crossed and all being well, in the first quarter of next year. So looking forward very much to that. And the other thing, I guess, that I've done that was a real adventure recently is a documentary called Navalny, which is directed by Daniel Roer, Canadian, another young director, Canadian, worked previously on the Robbie Robertson and the Band documentary, Once Were Brothers. But this was the story of Alexei Navalny and his Novichok poisoning and subsequent recovery and imprisonment, and it's sort of half detective story, half political documentary.
Yeah, and I love how different of a sound it is for you. When you listen to the music, it is very Cold War-ish. It's got a very, a darker tone, certainly, than Coda.
Yeah, well, we thrive on variety.
Absolutely, that's what it's all about. What would you say is the biggest piece? I know it's a common question, but it's something that really interests me. Because you get different answers with every single composer who have different backgrounds and different journeys. But what would you say is the biggest piece of advice, thing that you've learned that you hope other composers that are ascending sort of take with them? What's the biggest themes for you that have stuck throughout your career?
I learned this from Hans Zimmer to a great extent. It doesn't matter how good the music you make is and how talented you are and what a brilliant orchestrator you are. It's the people that you're working with and the way that you manage and conduct your relationships with them that is the most important thing, both in terms of personal satisfaction and in terms of ultimately doing the job well.
Marius, I am so grateful for your time today, and for those who have not seen it, Coda is available to watch on Apple TV+. And good luck with your next projects. I hope to chat again sometime.
All right. Thank you so much.